more need. As some background for myself, I've been a partner of GovCMS. I've been with GovCMS for some time, something like that during the war. I actually been in Brendan's position, but I used to run a team that was there. So all of those finance things that he needed to fix, were all the things I and the team broke at the time, had fun. Been around GovCMS for quite a while, did my first website on GovCMS in 2016, over at IP Australia, a bit of time there, did some more things, ran finance, eventually moved into finance to GovCMS. We're using Web Radar office today. I don't know if we've got the presentation for you anyway, so I also don't have a screen in front of me. This is really fun. Let's leave it like this. Can we all see that? Fantastic. Great. Like I also mentioned, while I work on quite a few things like this, we've put a lot of community representation into the year, and a lot of this announced thing is fantastic as well. So we've been doing a lot of activities with our customers. We've got a couple of things in the way, but of course Drupal turns out the one for the year, as it is for most people in the space. If it's not, please be in that space, whether you're working with us or not. Oh, that's good, by the way. I love technology. Importantly, I broke three laptops this week. I'm using this. We had a community presentation yesterday. I broke things in that presentation. I'm feeling like I'm winning all around today, so please bear with me, Carl.
How?
One's just a little work computer, so we don't have the buzzer, so that's just general use. My old Mac, which I haven't used in a while, it's not booting. I've learned that the RAM is not seated properly, or it's got too much dust in it, so that'll be surgery probably tomorrow, maybe not tonight. And the other one I've broken my other instances. So, having a lot of fun. So, yeah, feeling like a real winner. So, I mean, if anything, our presentation yesterday, for those who are involved in our community, at least it demonstrated some of the problems that our customers are going to have. So, you know, a bit of reality there for us. So, it wasn't intentional, I mean, they're certainly not better than intentional. Anyway, so, GovCMS. Quite a few of you know about GovCMS. For those of you that don't, by government, for governments. So, you don't have to use us, we're not going to force you to buy us or anything like that. If you'd like to come on the journey with us and work with another entity, that's fantastic. We'd love to have a chat. A lot of you probably know our colleague out there today as well, I think we keep calling our customer success manager. We love to chat, almost as much as I do. So he's also here to get on the call, but if you've got questions in those spaces, have me take them whether you're paying or not. Anyway, so, like I said, our big bonus here, most people use Drupal 10. Just to touch on a few more points about classes, like CMS, those faults are really small. So, the main touch points in this, we've got a challenge, what's our progress, what are our updates, what are the removals in there as well. I'll show you a pretty graph at least, I think it's pretty. We've got some remaining modules, some things that are sort of hanging around. We've got some end user issues. And we might as well have a bit of a look at you, provided I don't know this stuff in the inventory time as we go through these slides. Awesome. Alright. So, when we think of a challenge, well, we've all got a challenge if we need to do upgrades. When we think about GovCMS and the two offerings that we have software as a service, so we do all of that application, the security, and things behind the scenes. If you're as, hey, go forth, do what you need, try not to blow up a platform. And we'll wait here if we need to. But it's a bit more of a client's choice there. The biggest issue for the deadline is we've got 300 SaaS sites. That's a lot of customers. That's about 100-odd agencies. There's obviously different business owners. There's a lot of people we have to talk to. A lot of those people aren't engaged as the way we'd like. Some of them have a site that works. That's great. Well, we need to make sure it keeps working and doing these upgrades. Then we're running Drupal 9. Yay! So that's good, so we've got a starting base. We also did an upgrade process last time around because one just keeps getting handled too. But she does such a great job, which is why she's there. But we went walk through the process later tomorrow. We've got about 100 PaaS sites. And again, those customers are looking after themselves or solve at home. And of course, sometimes we have some interesting conversations with customers in that space. Most of those, that's about 75%, close to 80, I think, as a fact. We've got some legacy ones we won't bother with the problem managing in there, but what we'd like to hope is people are obviously progressing those, because Drupal 7 at this point in time hasn't ended up this year, I suppose we're saying. But of course, Drupal 9 will as well. So, thankfully, we don't have too much of a spread on the code base, but we don't know where people are for some of those things, and it's going to be a bit of an effort for us to chase them, but we're looking at about 20 to 25 sites. Thankfully, we're reducing that sort of technical debt. Drupal 7 was lovely, it hasn't made fun things for it, but the time is up. I'm talking to wife. We've also got a jump to 9.5 as well in the time. 9.5 and 10 are very similar. We're running 9.4.11, something like that. We don't have the most recent one that's coming in our next update, but we're obviously maintaining that because that's what we do with our sites. And we maintain our distribution, so of course we're all about data. Of course, the other one is what we can do. That one's a big sticking one that I wouldn't say it's keeping us up at night. We've had a lot of progress, but there's some ones that we have in our distribution that we really need to be able to either help move along or help those affected. That's a terrible start. Anywho, so again, for those of you not familiar, we roll our own distribution. So on top of hosting, if you're taking our SaaS offering, you are using that distribution. We have it fixed. We offer invites for people who are obviously suggesting things, and we keep it up to date, but it's otherwise a fixed sort of option. That helps us for updates, helps us for customers who don't sort of work in that space, who don't have the technical capability or the capacity to do those things, and it's kept secure and safe. And Carl, you didn't name drop yourself, but Carl used to work in that space. So all that good code that's in there is Carl's. But of course, that's what part of the team that we have at GovCMS, but also with our partner, Source Digital, behind the scenes. We maintain that distribution, we maintain our platform, so people can get really good things. Of course, you can use our distribution anywhere. You can run your own Drupal one if you has, whatever fonts you like. But with SaaS, we lock that down, and we lock it down for good reason. Anyway, we have a recurring release schedule that happens with those. We're up to 2.28, and since our 2.9 release, so that's 19, 20 releases ago, we've been adding modules in our Drupal team compatibility. So we've had some joy there with modules happening to get a 10 version release. Again, like I said, it's not a lot, but we're seeing a lot of progress. I'm happy, the ones sometimes happy. And of course, a big one for us with our distribution anyway. We've got some security functionality there, we've got some feature functionality, and of course, for us, we're also keen to try and have those as stable and secure release modules for obvious reasons. If we've got security advisory policies that we can obviously stick to, and people are obviously updating those things, that gives us a bit more confidence as part of the protection that we have from our offering over there. Another big one, and this has been one of those ones that we've been able to sort of quietly do behind the scenes. We found a lot of theming issues. This is the same thing that happened last time with 8-9. We've been able to make all those things eliminated behind the scenes. So we're doing a lot of those compatibility fixes where of course it makes sense for us to do so. So where we had lots and lots and lots of errors that are all the same, we've been able to put fixes in for those. So we're putting those as part of things. I'm very happy about that. Makes some of that a little bit easier. There'll be a couple of little ones here and there, but the vast majority of people have been an issue. For those of you who are registered in the theming space, Bootstrap IO is the one that gave us the most amount of grief. But thankfully, that theme gets updated through our upgrade to newer versions to resolve those problems. So that's been a nice sort of win we have behind the scenes as we progress things. For those of you who go to a lot of our meetings, if you work in that space, this chart's probably very familiar. Again, for those of you who are not, this is the sort of overarching idea of us getting to from 9 to 10. But currently, imagine that's animated, but the direction the arrows are going to. So of course, we're trying to build our distribution, make sure that all the things we've got work, and of course, hopefully not having things break. That's our big thing. Again, with all of those module interactions that are compatible, that gets us closer and closer. A big one, as I've said, is security. We have to do a security assessment. We need to use testing around that and validation. Again, that underpins a lot of the things I've talked about. We have a whole lot of statements like IRAP, and obviously, our system security plans and being safe and secure is a good thing. Very happy about that. Once we get through that, we get some more distribution, so that means we can put it out to the on the people can pull it from their GitHub repository. And then when we get to that sort of point, we'll actually be able to start deploying it to people's sites, fingers crossed. When we're talking at the moment, we're probably thinking security assessment, is that April, May, Yeah, so that's what we're hoping for. And then that sort of launch natural distribution that we can start updating to. We'll start trying, the potential production segments, at least for PaaS. We're hoping the month after. So, June. I'm hoping this side of the calendar year. Ever so slightly. It's the end of financial year, you'd like to give to the community. And then, of course, right down the end there with 5 and 6, with these people who are in SaaS sites, we want to automate those updates. Again, for those familiar with the community, we do this with other updates. We're doing it with a 9.5 preview bridge at the moment, so people can feel things work. And of course, we're getting into the window that can validate those things, that can tell us if something's broken or not working. And then as we chew through all of those, we'll get to a point where everyone's upgraded in SaaS. All those PaaS people are getting right on top of their stuff and getting right in front of those deadlines, and I won't have to chase a single person. And then we should be in front of that sort of life window. Now, of course, the end of life window is November. Our time frames, which I'll show on the next slide, we're trying to get in front of that. I hope you can make the work. Do not hit to leave the door. Sir, also, no we do. So, if you recall, as we talked about, we've got 300 SaaS sites. We have a finite amount of time. And we've got more people coming in the platform. Yay. That creates a big problem. We have a time frame, we need some wiggle room. We also have to chase a lot of people down. We also have to group people together and try to put them into sections. So that also needs to account for people's own time frames. Do they have any financial reporting requirements? Finance has a couple of those sort of common things. Other agencies have their own understanding of requirements. They have other activities going on. I know Brendan's going to rebuild something in the intermediary and he'll need some breathing room. I'm sure of it. So, for us, we want to stagger some groups, and we want to stagger them from the start of July through the end of September. That's not a lot of time from where I'm standing. I'm not sure about anyone else's views of that. I'm sure it's probably fantastic for someone who only owns one site.
Is that essentially term three of school, the school term?
You'll have to tell me, I'm not familiar with school term.
Okay. No,
it looks
like
do we have any more insights to those windows?
I think the first couple of weeks of July is usually the summer. So, like NAIDOC is usually the second of July.
Yeah. Okay. I'm getting a hand from the back of it sometimes. Sorry, Ron Archer didn't introduce himself earlier. Archer's, we'll get him on the talk shortly.
We don't want to damage him too early.
We'll let the labor laws decide that. So, of course, with these sort of spaces, we obviously want to have a 2-week window for where we've presented a preview break for someone to look at that we're running Drupal 10, running all those modules up to date, and then we get in there and validate things work. Now, that's all good in theory. It doesn't account for people being away, it doesn't account for other things that pop up. Emergency things from the minister's office and things like that always happen. And of course, all those other things I talked about as well, we need to potentially competing programs just in business name. But of course, we need to group people in somewhere, and hopefully, there's enough space in there, not just in those things we just talked about, that people can pick a spot that hopefully suits them, or at least allows them enough lead time to put a pause on something. Now, when we look at that window, that's 300 sites across 12 groups, which is 25 projects in 4 months. Now, that's more than doable from us at a technical level. it's possibly not as easy for us to be able to make sure everyone's on top of those things. And of course, there'll be a lot of phone calls, emails, and data services tickets from us to make sure people are on the front. Sites do slip, problems do occur, all of those things happen. It's one of the reasons why we're arguing for the September, end of September deadline, because then we do have that window. Again, I'm not being too where if we do have some of those bleed overs, it's not ideal, but at least we're not in the life. We've got some theoretical room to breathe. That doesn't mean that everyone gets to come in and go, oh, I'm in this time. I still wanted it as window as a first preference point. Obviously each one of those are fortnightly, and then at the end of that window, if everyone's good, or even beforehand, we're given to go, we'll go and hit those buttons and make that happen. So if it only takes you a day to turn around a small site, great. We could probably spin that very quickly and get it out the door to 10 live. If it's going to take you the full 2 weeks because you've got the new side of the platform, I don't think anyone here works on that, but nonetheless. That's the side, this dream idea of how these things work. Again, this is very much a bold idea from the last time around, and I think it worked pretty well. There's always going to be some gaps, there's always going to be some fallovers, people need to move through it. But
the one thing that I'll add is at the point when we start the security assessment, we'll have like a release candy with open 10, that will also be able to review the things. So in addition, as a last year or last time around, we just had it 2 weeks, this time around we're trying to do March time this financial year, you know, this side of that window.
If I get a site in this range, does that mean I can use the release candidate? If it's not going to be launched until the end past September,
you should be fine with logistics. Obviously, I'd like to be at a point where we can have a 10 that's available, but we can spin up a SaaS customer.
Mm-hmm.
If, of course, you're a PaaS customer, again, you've probably got that freedom.
Yeah.
It'll depend on obviously what the work is, what's coming to build. It's one of these ones that when we're having initial engagement conversations, Kevin and I do quite a few when people are interested in coming to our platform or having a new project, we're also warning them about that 9.5 preview as well. 9.5 currently isn't live, we're still on 9.4, but it's a similar sort of point where if you're timed knowing that something will happen, or it doesn't start to lock about facts, then we'll see. And of course, if it's not yet live, those things move on as well. So, if in doubt, everything matters there. Because again, some of these other things may adjust. You might be able to start sooner, you might have to start later. But I'd like to sit with you and let you go. Cool. Then, like I said, we have distribution, we have distro for all intents and purposes. We're going to read a couple of things. In my view, it's cleaning up some technical debt. We'll start over in the Dawn, so we'll start with Dawn GovCMS. GA login. It's if you're using Google Authenticator to log in for your 2-factor authentication. That's been wrong to do another module, but you already have that module. It's gone. Bye-bye. We're looking at getting the features and the block types. Ruby, high-use sort of things. Features functionality is very much done by configuration. I don't know if anyone really uses it in space. Block place was an experimental module. It worked that you can use things in the layout builder or placing blocks otherwise behind the scenes. No screen if anyone knows, it's got no support going forward, makes no sense for us to do. We've got a couple of things that we're trying to get rid of. And at least one of those is the magnet wide distance at the moment. Video in midfield. It was a lovely one that helped us when we were in media early on in Drupal Act. It wasn't really a good way to embed things as we started to transition towards media from 7 to 8. That helps for just putting them in on YouTube and things like that. We've got about 40 sites left using that. I'm already talking to people about that. And I'm hoping most of them can be upgraded. There is an upgrade path for most of it. There's a couple more sub-modules that don't have an upgrade path. That's where I'm doing the lens with those customers at the moment. Again, embed all of those things with the media interface. Again, it's just, this thing we don't want to do. So why should we not have it split with it? It's a bit. A minimal theme, so if you're used to like headings and menus, if you've a bit of responsive things there. It hasn't been up by part of the money. It's also just an administration thing, so for the most part, it shouldn't really have someone's experience. It was on my default for a very long time, so quite a few people might actually notice a difference when we do that one, but there shouldn't be a functional change. A few more here. We have a label deprecated here, panels and analyzer. Panels has been upgraded to 10. Analyzer, I don't think at this stage. Most of that functionality is in layout building, you can do it in other ways, but templating, building, all those sorts of things. We do have a bit of a legacy though. We have 100 plus sites that use those things or at least have them on. So what we'll do is we'll make sure we're just not going to a lot of new sites. We're probably going to have to maintain that. I don't think we can get 100 plus sites to be able to change all of the things in our house before we start doing that schedule that we've got. So we'll support that behind the scenes. People can build things and close things off, or if I've just got one aren't using it, hopefully we can put like this away. And we're not going to run anyone else to those things on the other way. We're going to block those things, and we're going to push people in as layout builder, or you know, your weapon of choice when you do it otherwise. Those are a bit harder, just because of the game. But again, they're not going to get a huge amount of support out there regardless. So for us, it feels like it makes sense. But we're going to be on the other side of our team to upgrade it. We just don't have the time on this side of it. Cool. Now, I don't do too many drafts, but I think it's pretty, so whatever. this is just showing our graph. So, our table here, which is then represented by our chart, these are the releases we've had. Like I said, we've had 19, 20 of them. And we've had a bunch of additions. This is the growth in how many DTM compatible modules are in our distribution. At the moment, at the current release, we've got 68 of them. Almost nice. Almost nice. But of course, in most of these, we've been able to add something every time. That's because of what the community's already doing. Most of those we haven't really had to push or do anything there. People on Drupal side are already pushing towards that. So that's why I'm happy when I see something like this, because it's only going to happen. These are the good ones. And of course, like I said, 2.1, it was quite a while ago. I don't know, with Search Engine 9 or Search Engine 6 or something. Someone was really on the ball. On average, we normally do around 72 to 3 weeks. Just for some context there. Just in how far that's been good. Alright. These fonts are horrible. I'll read them out. So, we've got a few more that are coming down the pipeline. They'll be in a future release. Configuration split, contact storage, dynamic entity reference, our own GovCMS consultation module, update notifications disabled. I'm sure that means a lot to all of you here. These are things that we already have on within the distribution. They're ready to go. They have Drupal changes, they are stable. We just haven't put them in the release yet. A lot of that just comes back to the time and energy we have to be able to put them in and validate them all into everything else. On top of security patching, testing everything, there's all that sort of stuff. A few more at the pipeline. This is the other one that I'm not as happy about. Other modules we use, still making good progress. We've got 5, 10, 14, 15 of them. These ones with this sort of tinge of brown. They at least have, well, a working alpha, beta, release candidate, something. They're not stable, but they're at least going in the right direction. I'd rather not put them in as this, but if we had to in a pinch, we probably would. But hoping that we will see those turn over stable. A lot of these ones, components, context, focal points, webform, they're all heavily used in the community. They've always previously had stable things. I think it's just a bit of time for those ones. Our other ones there don't have a color against them. A couple of those we're working with some vendors to update. Big Ben, we're talking with vendors next about. CPNCAD, PDF, we're talking with Doncast about. They've both had developers in that space before. And I'm hoping to see if they can help us move those away. A couple of these other ones, I'm a bit worried about. I'm very worried about it in bed. That's a big one from a content publishing perspective. I'll cry about that a bit more in a couple of slides. The other one here, Symphony Mallow, which is our blue purple one. It's one of these ones we're going to want to move to. So script mail that we have behind the scenes, and it was a very big talking point in a recent presentation we did, is the work we're going to have. I had made a 10 upgrade, and script mail seems to be these days. It now has several lots. I'm not sure if it's solved a couple of the problems we had for it, but that'll probably be one of those ones we do a bit later once we get to one of those others. So, yeah.
I think
TFA
is stable now.
Yeah, I think
it is. I hope so. That was my 2 months ago at Alpha 2, so maybe?
I think it does. We sort of on the subject of it.
Yeah,
get up there and do your talk.
Yeah, that's it. Well, if you want to finish my slides off, we can work that. Similar to this panels and panelizer thing we talked about, we've got a couple of these ones where I sort of think they're not necessary emails. My great problem is how to get permissions by time. Some of these are some of these legacy sites that have had these things in place and maybe haven't had the resources to go back and refactor things, haven't had the money to keep the building, whatever. Of course, the new pavement in 2023? Probably not.
Yes.
Yeah, we've got a lot of panels. So a couple of these, and this doesn't impact on large amount of sites, it's a very small subset. So similar to our panel's conversation, I want to keep pushing on those, but there's other sort of things like that. But again, one of these ones I'd really like to cross off this list as a part of this move. Being in front of it, fantastic. There's a couple of others which we use, but we don't have any of the distribution of it. Of course, these have got their own upgrade units, so I'm sure if anyone's ever run a deployment on the GovCMS site, they're probably going to be in their own backups and attack on our purge. So you'll be familiar with that. And a couple of friendly purge ones as well. These are things that we use at the platform level, so they potentially act in dance like modules, but when you pull down their distribution, you're not going to have those things in that wall. So we are using these extra ones here as well, just not as part of that index that we use there. So we're obviously keen to make sure these get progressed as well. Some of those things, claim AV, fast 404, a couple of our purging tools, stage 5 proxy, love it. A couple of other little things like that. So it isn't a lot of things that people would use day in, day out, but they are things that sort of make up what they're doing. Okay. Numerous issues with CK over 5, as I mentioned about earlier. it's great if you know what you're doing and if you know how to put in a release, you know how to put in CSS, and you know how to push those changes through. Again, if you're a customer that doesn't have a lot of technical in-house in the space, doesn't have an existing contract with a development partner, or don't have developers in-house, it's going to be a lot harder. And this is the one that Bob and I are spending a lot of time trying to get people to understand what potential challenges are here, effort involved, and if there's any way we can potentially shortcut or improve that experience. I also had a bit of cry yesterday, so the editor, in my presentation. The main ones, style treatment, CK5 is really a lot more explicit than 4. A lot of style things haven't come over, which I found upstream, when there's a lot of commentary around those. Like I said, customer engagement is a big one for us. It's always a challenge. People are just trying to do their more than that. It's not a reality that people get to stop and be able to come in the next thing, right? Or even know what it is. Which touches to our technical understanding. And then, of course, even this understanding of what is in CK5, which was the main driver for all of us yesterday. So, those are the things that we set.
When you say with the table styles that the options are limited in CK5, does that mean it's got less functionality than 4, or it's just different in some of the stuff as it sort of filtered through it?
It's probably the latter there, what we're talking about. It's different, and some of it hasn't filtered through. So when you think about the numeracy week, you can still generate a table, you can put in all the things. Have the lovely button that says make this a header row, make this a header column. Great. If I never apply style to that to say, okay, I want zebra style, so we've got those alternating row colors, I can't apply style to a table through that style object. I have to go source, I can put a class and I can still remove those things. And that's fine for someone like me. I mean, I've been doing that for way too many years now, but for someone who publishes an annual report once a year, that's not going to work. And part of that's also depending on how you build your site, what sort of material you put up, different story, if it's just write a component or a paragraph that you built that does it all for us. If you've just got that generic text box, that's probably, for most people in here, that's probably going to be okay with working size. For a lot of other people, that's not going to be. And that's the problem we have with an audience, where we've got super technical people, we've got people who just publish content. So it's one of those gap things that we're always trying to bridge. There's a bit of a history thing here. Drupal 9, 4 at the moment, sit there before. We're turning on 5 for the number of 5 previews, so people can try it. But sit there before is still the default. But when we hit 10, sit there before 5 is default. So I'm hoping people can tell me all their problems now, so we can either feed them back upstream or hopefully have solutions for them, getting them to open. So that's one of the battles. And of course, that doesn't even touch more on our technical things like very quickly, the skim on those. Entity embed, which I bemoaned earlier. It's that lovely one where you press the button and you pick the media just in a messy way. And then you put in the text and you put alt text and you say, hey, I want to do it. And then it presents the content. Entity embed is not ready yet. And again, when you think about that audience, like we just talked about them, that's going to be bad news for people who are doing that. It's potentially bad news for people who already have that rendering because it also uses a good one. It's a tag, I believe, or some description. This could be bad news bears for quite a few people. So that's the one, this is the one that's going to keep me up here. LinkedIn had a similar problem up until last week. Thankfully it's fixed, and we were able to deploy that to those 1.5 branches. So we've knocked off at least one of those problems again because of what's going on upstream points. This is the one that really worries me from an end user who isn't very technical, who's doing content, and just trying to maintain their stuff. Minister Sykes is one of those ones that really sort of is really cause for concern. Anywho, getting actually to the end of my slide deck after about 4 years. Joseph, who's not here with us tonight, who works in our space on GovCMS, he's been working away putting together the distribution. We actually had this sitting on its own repository up until last week. But what he's done is he's actually put it on its own branch on our actual GovCMS repo. So it's where everyone else is grabbing things, if you're trying to control them, you can jump to that develop branch and you can pull the thing down and you can play with it like that. So importantly, lay, prod, no. But there's something that people can now pull, they can pull publicly, and if you've got a feel for how to do those things, or maybe it's a journey into that space, you can actually do that. Again, like we've talked about, we have Alistair distribution and compatible modules. So there's going to be a few of them that aren't going to actually play exactly as we like. Excuse me. But there's at least something we do if we know what's actually coming down the pipeline. Now I know I've just, you know, enthralled you all with my talk, but I suppose we might as well show something. I know how you all like playing with your sites, so I thought I'd put it there. Well, I did skip a couple of steps ahead. For those who saw Brendan's presentation last time, I think that was fantastic. Doctor's a bit slower. I did some of those doctor things already. So hopefully I don't talk all night. This is me running this one lately. This is our previous version because I was worried about that in the bacon, as per example earlier in the session. But we'll just go through this. But gives me the ability, at least likely, to install a new thing from a couple of weeks ago. Really. Dangerous. Where's the errors? Side of groups. I have no address for sharing group.
Nice try, buddy.
Oh, sorry. There we go. And we'll just change it locally, and I'm going to put production. So that in. So again, like most of these GovCMS installs, it's nothing really different than what's been happening. We've already got this one up there, lovely. Sydney and Blue. Yeah, we'll get you those notifications for
you. I want them, man. I always uncheck that box.
That's a shame. Okay. So, you've seen a GovCMS site before. This is as exciting as it starts with. Well, yeah, I know, calm down. We do a couple of things. We bring in a couple of our own content types. We have a couple of little menu things here, but we have a very sort of vanilla sort of style. So again, if you're familiar with our platform, and you can put this down for our current state of origin, you'll get something like this. If you get something provisioned on our platform, we've always spit it up with our vanilla one as well. So before you actually commit anything to it, or if you're not working locally, this is probably what you're going to see when you get that initial password and project access level. I mean, for the average person, it's very much the same. There's no real difference to other things, but it seems it dances and for the most part it works. We obviously have no content, but we can manage it. The big one, importantly, we'll be doing that about 5,000 times. Look at that. 10.0.4. Again, this is just from a week or two ago, that's probably out of date now, but we can obviously spend something. Obviously, I didn't have to put a simple light on my production, that's why I said it. But again, we've got something that for the most part seems advances. The problem that we're going to run into things at its current state is, of course, if we then take that next logical step and go, okay, well, hands it up to my side. I'm not going to do that tonight. Explosions. Previously mentioned. Of course, the advantage of having this local mirror says you can go and grab a copy of your database from our dashboard or from whatever group or site we're using, and of course, you can import it. You can then bring the files over, you can bring the thing over, then go, does it work? So, of course, that's usually what I find people are looking to do at these sort of points. We've also got people who want to be on the bleeding edge or be in front of things, and that's the next thing I'm going to do. With my fixed laptops. But of course, again, when we think about some of those modules that might not be up to date, they may function, they may not, they probably have a linear at some point, they can straight up just work. It really depends on how complex some of these things are, how they're encoded, how they step up many things, but that's how we go about it. And at this point, when we talk about that, if you're not familiar, I've got some of this repository on GitHub. Hopefully that's a good enough name, GovCMS, GovCMS. We've got a couple of branches here. Develop, which is our current development one. So Joseph and Nana and the rest of the team, when we're doing things, we're working here. We obviously have our master and our tag releases, so you can see our latest updates. But you can switch these to three, and you can see our work with time. There'll be comments in the composer, there'll be some other comments here. And Joseph's been putting together some documentation on how to build this stuff locally. I think it's the best to stick with for a while. And we're also talking about it on our Slack spaces as well. So of course, if you're really keen, of course, if you're a Docker and a composer and have a normal kit, you put all your SSH keys set up locally, I'll let you go. So yeah, that's pretty much it in a nutshell. Very large nutshell, but that's where we're at. Several things still to do, but we're progressing. And yes, a couple of things that will fix up tonight, but hopefully not for our customers. Questions, comments? Oh, and one more thing as well. Sorry, I couldn't tell you the finishing one. There's a password lock on for outside of us.
Yeah. Yeah, just to, I'm guessing you would have a subset of sites that you've actually tested the migration on.
Yes.
What's your experience been like?
It depends. Of course, when we think more of those, and like when we use the term brochure, where we've got a couple of sites that fall into that category because that was an important policy of the program, or there was an announcement. Those ones, because it's usually just straight up content, simple theme, and not using that box, don't get a lot of problems. Most of those go smooth sailing straight through. It's more when you get to the heavier sites, when you have a lot of things that cross need, when you get very large products. I think there was a problem, I'm not sure if I agree, but I think there was a translation thing that also popped up recently. And that's going to impact quite a few sites because we've got some big ones that want to put material out to different audiences. That one's going to be harder. They've also just got a lot more content. So with those ones, reviewing how those things are put together, who built it at the time, all those sorts of things, I think there's a lot of unknowns. But when I think about our previous experience with what we've done tonight, I think with us getting 1.5, we're only now those problems there, 1.4, 1.5, but they're already 1.5, 10, probably getting a lot less than people. So I'm hoping all of that team is happening right now. Certainly the feeling I'm getting on our service desk from the chats that we're having with customers. At least those that are engaging with us, to go back to a couple of points. Again, because we're already, I wouldn't suggest anyone starts building on it. Obviously, I'm never confident.
I'm never confident, I'm not going to.
Whatever you want to find, actually. So that's why I'm feeling okay about it. If anything, it's just going to be some of those modules that are going to keep happening. Some of those touch to security aspects for us. So those are going to be also core aspects for us. Who wants to hear me stop talking?
Besides the care of five,
yeah.
Is there any other thing to look forward to in Triple 10?
Look, I think when we talk about a couple of the modules that we mark there, we obviously have consultation and DBF hanging around for quite a while. We get just enough conversations about it all the time. I've sort of sat to the left of the distribution for a long time. What I want to do is I want to get them into the distribution, so at least we've got those smells that are hanging around that was part of that. There's a couple of other things that are sitting around our issues queue which need a bit of love in bulk upload. What is one of them? I'd like to get that in there as well. I think for the most part, just because of that volume, we're really just trying to get people to that point first, and then we can get back to that, hey, let's actually think about these features and enhancements and stuff like that. I think we're in that sort of middle ground of possibly a bit too hard at the moment, or it's too much effort, I think, with the resources we've got. I think that's probably the better. Sadly, no.
Just on that, so Drupal versioning coincides with Symfony, what, major versions of Symfony?
Yeah.
So are there any, like, prizes, like, that Symfony's giving you, like at that lower level? Are there any nice things coming?
I don't know. I cannot answer. I'd like them to have a bit of a longer lifespan, so we can have a bit of a longer lifespan. So
how long is it anyway? So when's Drupal?
The first one. We always get the question. I have no idea at this point. I'm trying to think that far. But why not next year?
Why not?
Cool. All right. Well, I'll leave it there. Thank you.